afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here for another session of Toward a Quality of Life, coming to you on May 17th, a Sunday afternoon in 1998, 3:30 p.m. We're here at the Roxbury studio of BNN-TV at the Washington Street Mall in Roxbury. Our topic is further discussion of psychology, as has been our topic for a couple of previous sessions now. Now, the last time we were talking about some basic principles, and that's what I'm going to try to do, is rather than give you a bunch of facts and figures in a fragmented, divided sort of way, I'm trying to first explain to you foundations and basic assumptions as we go along in talking about psychology. As I had said previously, psychology is an outgrowth of philosophy itself, and behind psychology and any scientific endeavor, any academic or scholarly endeavor in any field, are assumptions, philosophic assumptions at root about the nature of life, the nature of knowledge, the nature of cause, the nature of explanation. So interwoven in trying to get to some of the basic theories, principles, known facts of the science of psychology, we will continue to review throughout some of the underlying philosophic assumptions, explanatory assumptions. And one of these, from the last time we were speaking, was a notion of teleology. The idea, and since that time I've come up with an explicit definition for our purposes, the idea of explaining, quote-unquote, or describing natural processes as proceeding in the unfolding of or according to immanent reason, as in cause. That is to say, the idea that there is an ulterior design, that things come to be what they are because of some greater purpose outside of the organism, some greater purpose intrinsic to life, but not part and participle of the individual or specific organism in particular. And I was at the previous session somewhat faulting sort of evolutionary teleologies or evolutionary philosophic underlying kind of ideas that give a survivalist or evolutionarily good fit to some of the kinds of things that happen in nature and happen in organismic responding. And as you recall, some of the examples I gave were a cat's rubbing affectionately against oneself being shown to be a matter of being said to be a matter of the animals releasing hormones from glands in its face, whereas I said, can we not just look at behavior and activity in the present and not attribute these grand design causes to it, such that we more or less demystify and in a sense ruin the natural nature of what is occurring, as well as perhaps have no reason to think we understand what purposes are in the ultimate sense about what occurs in nature. Another example we gave was about children playing and the idea that they play in order to learn about the environment in some ulterior way, whereas really children play to play, as do any young animals. And let us just talk about the nature and substance of behavior as it occurs for itself. Now, animals and people and life does have purposed, but purpose in the sense of something more specific to the acting agent. So, for example, if a rat presses a lever to get food, that is for a purpose, but the purpose rests with the acting organism. We're not talking about a rather evolutionarily kind of conceptualized purpose where we deem to know the reasons people and things are doing what they're doing from some ulterior outside purpose that has kind of made whatever is occurring at the moment happen over some kind of long historical time. Similarly, if we had an instance of an animal or an infant seeking what is known as contact comfort, that is, to feel warm and be able to touch and be attached to physically another figure, typically a guardian, a caretaker, a parent, so to speak. I don't like that word, caretaker. It's also a demystifying, neutralizing, and sort of scientificizing of life kind of word. But we don't have to talk about that in terms of any kind of evolutionary benefit that an infant would be protected by its mother and so on. No, we merely need to talk about it as beneficial, as being comforting and necessary in the biological and psychological makeup of the organism, as being a matter of health, as being a matter of love, feeling, touch, warmth, and not even a matter of what we sometimes refer to as bonding, which is such a cold word, but merely a matter of people and organisms and life and animals needing each other and wanting, when they're not spoiled, when they are in the natural form and able to be the best they can be, the most beautiful they can be, wanting to affiliate, wanting to feel close, and wanting to feel contact comfortable. So I wanted to begin bringing up some of these points about teleological definitions and bring teleology, if at all, right down to the acting organism and its sense of purpose. Another description, and I think I will make reference here too. The last time I was speaking, I had spoken of a physicist who had answered that laws in physics were orderly because he felt God wanted it that way, which would be another example of sort of an outside teleological notion of some kind of ultimate design. And what I'm trying to say is we cannot perhaps know those kinds of things. We can only know what we really are as experiencing creatures. Next we have a word I'd like to bring up immediately, which is phenomenology, and I do use that word quite a bit, and to define it today, it is the study of the appearance and occurrence of behavior as it exists to our senses. So everything just as you really feel it and do it and experience it is the phenomenology of your life, and it kind of has a flow. Even if that flow is interrupted, even if that flow is tense, whatever it is, it's a continuous stream of life and organismic activity that never has an end point, that is a continuing thing while you sleep, that is a continuing thing no matter where you are in time. And you are always with your consciousness, you are always with your psyche, you are even with your life if you are in a coma. There is, and we don't know about death, death seems to be, at least to our observation, a point at which the manifestation of psyche or soul, we're not using soul in the religious sense, but the activating breath principle, life principle, lifeness of what you are, is not as apparent to us at a time of death, but during life, it is your lifeness, and the phenomenology of it is a never-ending flow, a never-ending story. And what do we mean by behavior? We always use that word behavior. Behavior is the kind, quality, description, essence of an action, the substance of an action. When I do something like this, there is substance to it. When I am speaking, hopefully there is substance to it. Even no matter what it is, there is some substance to everything we do, say, or feel. There's an essence to it. There's a character to it. There's a constitution to it. There are basic elements of it, essentials, essences of behavior, of life, of psyche, of the soul. And so it is these essences of action, thought, feeling, words, gestures, or tones, and how different the tone of how we perform behaviors or feel them or speak them and so on can be for the essence or the meaning of what we're doing at any point in time. The gesture, tone, word, and so on of living organisms. And organisms is sort of a neutral word, again, a kind of scientificizing, demystifying word that ranks all life forms, all animate forms on one continuum of organismic or organism life, lifeness. So that would go anywhere from the single-celled paramecium all the way up to the mighty elephant, whale, and even human beings. The tone, gestures, thoughts, feelings of organisms as apparent to sense perception. Behavior is the kind, quality, description, essence. As apparent to sense perception, we perceive, we can know things, perhaps, or we sense things the way we think we sense them, biologically contained within the kind of wired biological animal we are, specific to ourselves. We sense things, perceive them, with our five senses. Some people talk about six senses. And those senses are, of course, touch, sight, smell, sound, and taste. Five senses. And so it's our sense perception that can see the behavior, the kind, the quality, the essence of it, know it, smell it, hear it. And it's apparent to us phenomenologically as it appears in time, be in the experience. And as it is apparent to sentience, S-E-N-T-I-E-N-C-E, sentience, your feeling, your awareness, your pain, your suffering, your the fact that if someone pricks you with a pin, you feel that. Or if you become scared, it's you that goes through that. You are sentient. Your tissue is not just tissue. By you being made up of the biological tissue that you are feeling things all the time. You can't avoid it. You're in a state of sentience. Sentience. From physical things to emotional things to cognitive, and we had that word before, cognition being mental processes, thought processes, and so on. So behavior as apparent to our sense perception, as apparent to our sentience of feeling and knowing being alive, as apparent to our consciousness as in the sense that we are awake and conscious, hopefully, to a degree. We are able to kind of be cognizant that we are somewhere. Even animals are conscious in this sense of the word. If you take an animal to an unfamiliar environment, that animal may well be sniffing around and sometimes be fearful, aware of the novelty, and you can see that by the behavior, by the essence of the behavior, by the quality and description of the behavior. That animal is conscious. That animal is awake and alert and, in a sense, knowing. And finally, we can know behavior by our awareness. Awareness is a bit more than consciousness. These all have subtle shades of different meaning. And awareness is like, for example, I could be in this room or in this life and I could have a certain amount or number of elements or substance of life that is aware, that is something I kind of carry with me and know it's happening and know it's real and have a cognizance of it. And that awareness can be larger or smaller. you can be aware of much more. Even people talk politically or sociologically about being aware. Are you aware, for example, what living in prison would be like? It would be a kind of expanded awareness if you had it. And one can have this sometimes to a degree with having the experience or with not having the experience. You could have awareness of what people are doing or where you are in space and time, people that aren't necessarily right next to you and telling you something, and yet your awareness can be bigger. You could be in a conference room and sort of be aware of what many of the people are thinking in a general sort of sense. You can pick out the tone. So awareness. Now, it has been said, and I myself have experienced, it has been said when you practice an art, maybe even boxing, but certainly one like karate, and you become, not for its violent potential or for its aggressive potential, but if you practice it for its mind conditioning, for its discipline to your body, mind, and soul, and you live the clean and disciplined life of what such an endeavor requires, you will notice without even trying to have this happen that your awareness will become bigger and bigger and bigger of things around you. Your hearing is better. Your knowledge of what's going around you becomes better in a very physical sense. So in sum, further, behavior is all organismic responsivity, that you have some kind of response, be it a twitch, be it an eye blink, be it a thought, be it an awareness, be it a feeling, be it a consciousness, being a smell, whatever it is, responsivity in a state of life. Life being not death. Life being able to respond. Life being conscious, or life being sentient, or life being in a state of active neural energy, if you will. Finally, for definitions, deriving from some of the previous sessions that we've had together, I'd like to again point out the definition of psychology as a behavioral description, which is very different in general than a teleology, a behavioral description, more like a phenomenology, of the intricate organization of what a person does, says, or feels. A description, an ability to tell what is going on and why it is going on, perhaps causally, and where it is likely to go because of what has come before or what has come now, and from observation and from a very disciplined language and a very disciplined definition of terms and meaning, a knowledge that can provide us with some understanding, some grip on the human condition, the human psyche, the human soul, human behavior. Certainly not the meaning of life. That is for another topic, raised to a different plane in a different place, but to understand what makes us as humans do what we do, feel what we feel, and what are we likely to do and feel given certain circumstances in a very physically manifest world, a world that does represent itself to our senses, hardly totally, but as the wired creatures we are, does present itself to us for discovery. I'd like to point out here that some of the ways that we are proceeding in psychology and other disciplines as well, medicine and so on, has to an extent gone overboard with dry and commercialized, trivialized, diluted, and compartmentalized activities around deciding who we are, what we do. We're very busy studying, running studies on any number of picayune or specific, very specific tangents of the overall picture of human life. And in medicine, and physiology, we've broken down the degrees to which we look at specific things in isolation to very, very fine points, sometimes contradicting each other on the face of it, because medical or physiological life is so complex as to not be understood sometimes in isolation, and you even get often results that you hear about that contradict each other and seem to go on forever as having no end point in knowing what so-called answers are. But my point here is disregarding so-called answers for the moment, what are the real questions and what is it we should be studying? And if we are studying, how should we do that? Should we be doing it with a lot of fragmented, very specific, narrowly targeted studies, which can be challenged often by the way those studies are conceptualized or framed, to say the least, of protocols used and underlying analyses, mathematical or other, of the data, precursing theories on which they are based or hypotheses, and so on and so on. And we have no synthetic midpoint or central point from which to grab hold of all this information, more properly called, and get a knowledge that we could really sink our teeth into, so to speak, and feel that we really are going to a higher place in understanding. The kind of studying we often hear about and see so proliferated is not gestalt. Gestalt being a word that is about wholeness, the wholeness of something. How parts are not all added together, do not make the whole. The whole is something different and something unique and must be known as a whole. Deep and meaningful kinds of knowledges also cannot be gathered necessarily by an array of fragmented studies, so to speak, research studies. We can know so much by listening, not listening because we are hired to do so, or listening because we feel we have to do so, or we're trying to find out an answer to a specific question, but just listening to the life around us, taking it easy, and enjoying life for every moment, and suffering life too, as suffering comes, to not fear suffering. Suffering we must all do, and to delve in, to jump into the pool of life, so to speak, and to live it and to listen and to be in it is a very valuable way to learn about it and to know about it. And if we are disciplined in our approach, if we are very strict with our language and our thinking, if we are very strict with the manner in which we proceed when we practice science regarding this, we can come to some very useful knowledge of the sort that will almost help us with a sense of purpose in life, if you will, a meaningful purpose, so to speak. And the more we are busy as we are today, finding out this little bit of information and that little bit of information and working on this project and that project and talking to people only for those kinds of things to occur in common between us and kind of shielding ourselves or ignoring the rest of all that is going around us phenomenologically, then we are not being to that extent. Being. Jean-Paul Sartre, just occurs to me, talked about being and nothingness. In other words, either you are being or the nothingness is the void, the great big void. And some people you see in music, you see in other areas of life, people talk about not feeling that they're in life and able to be, and they feel more of the void. Those that are in existential crisis, if you will. And we are also not relating. And as I have said on several occasions, we don't, maybe you can relate, for example, to what I'm telling you right now. Maybe you can, maybe you cannot. But that's the meaning the word has come to have today. The kind of relating I'm talking about is literally relating. Looking at your whoever's next to you and talking about whatever. Who cares what it is? And relating, being in communication, if you will, contact comfort, so to speak, with other human beings, with animals, with nature, with life. We also neglect nature when we rush around on all the tasks of information gathering and studying. We're studying and studying to a degree that we have to ask, what is it you're studying? If everybody's busy studying and everybody's busy learning what's coming out of all these so-called studies, what is life really about? Isn't life about just what somebody's finding out from a study, and is it not really life itself? I say more power to observation, more power to listening, more power to phenomenology, more power to talking with each other, more power to watching and increasing our awareness of everything around us. Now, also on this subject, as I mentioned, questions of little or no significance are played to the hilt. Because they are driven by commerciality. And today, it's very hard, if not almost impossible, to do any sort of work that doesn't have behind it some kind of funding. And the funding most often has commercial ties to a great degree in one sense or another in the long run. So people are even framing questions according to whether they would be able to be funded or sell what it is they're talking about. And these cannot be true questions. And these cannot find true science. These cannot define true science. These cannot find true life. It's almost like life for sale, the environment for sale, products for sale, people for sale, human resources for sale. We do things like talk about cholesterol levels, which are make a big deal out of them. I'm not saying they're not important, but we've put the cart before the horse. In a life of living and dying in three-quarter time, to quote Jimmy Buffett, in a life of life is here, you're born, and then you die, and you don't know, and you're very insecure often about death and about why you're alive to begin with and about the suffering that you want to deny and the pain and the fear and the anguish, you hardly need to know your cholesterol level per se in a paramount sort of sense. This is a very low-level question. Yet all these kinds of low-level questions, of which there are so many, seem to come before what we need to do as being healthy, wholesome, relating, communing people. We get into great lengths and exaggerations about the toilet paper we use and of what it is composed and how it makes us feel. That's a kind of absurdity. We send animals up in a space shuttle called Columbia recently, and of course I'm very against the use of animals in this manner. And some of the research going to be done on, I don't know if it's on the astronauts themselves, or maybe it is, or on the animals, is sleep research. And were we more observational, more phenomenological, more descriptive, more here and now, we would know that getting a good night's rest is dependent on having a more relaxed life, a more meaningful life, a more connected life to yourself, the people around you, and to the universe. And so many things we are going through to learn about sleep, taking medications, staying in laboratories overnight, the sleep problem is mounting. Well, it's like cancer. The real causes are right before our very eyes. The way we are living is inimical to sleep. the pace at which we are living, and we're not going to go into a discussion of how we could better help ourselves sleep in a practical sort of way. But again, we're going on out of this world, so to speak, on things that should be addressed much more fundamentally, much more phenomenologically, observationally, profoundly in everyday existence. The mintiness of mouthwash, things like twin studies, the age-old question of how much is heredity, how much is environment, and to a degree, not to disrespect any point of view, but to a degree, who cares, really? Who cares for a genetic answer and so on? This question has been going on for so long. I think it's much more telling and not at all imprecise. It's an observation. It's a fact of life. I can recall when Roseanne Barr found out that she, after she had become famous, she apparently found out where a daughter of hers was, or that she had, I can't remember, but a daughter that did not know her. Oh, the daughter never knew the mother, that Roseanne Barr was her mother. She was adopted, I believe. And many years later, when the daughter is in her late teens or 20s, Roseanne contacts her, I believe, and the idea is, the point is that the daughter gets to know Roseanne as her mother. And when they interview the daughter, I saw the video of it, when she first finds out, she has identical mannerisms and essences and ways and properties as does Roseanne. And she apparently had no contact and didn't have the wildest idea that she was the daughter of Roseanne. There is some excellent evidence on the issue of heredity versus environment, and certainly it is there, but do we need to study it and pin it down to 61%, which will never be possible? There are too many gazillion, gabillions, millions, zillions of physical points of reality to ever be able to manage all of them in the complexity that they coexist in space and time to pinpoint such phenomena. And it's so much nicer to just observe people, know people, and see generalities, see kinds of things that do seem to be true about them. Cancer research, doing all kinds of very hurtful, painful things to animal, and again, even if they're done with kindness, with anesthesia, they are deliberate, and no one would want to have a tumor grown in him or herself on purpose, even with proper medical care. You'd rather not volunteer yourself for such an experiment. So that's how it is with the animals. No matter how nicely something is done, the point is it never should be done to begin with. And we're looking around for all these cancer cures. The television is full of this right now. And yet we have things like frogs, vastly reduced in number around the world, and apparently going unabated in that direction, as far as I know to date. And very deformed, being born very deformed. And now the next question that comes to us is, gee, why are these frogs being born deformed? We're disconnected from life, from the universe. Our automatic response should be perhaps something is causing these, something that is causing bad things to biology. And if not only, and if to frogs, it's not only to frogs, it's to life itself. I remember when so many seals died in Norway, thousands and thousands of some disease that just came and went and took the lives of so many of them. And this is happening to animal life all over the place. And you know, maybe when we just stand around and say, gee, we have to study it, we have to study everything. We can't live it, we can't know it, we can't observe it, we can't feel it, we can't be in touch with it. I'm not saying to make false decisions. I'm not saying to make rash decisions or go back to superstitious kinds of beliefs, but I am saying to take a hard edge of thinking properly and to base it on what you do know about the way the universe works, and not disjoin yourself in some kind of splintered fashion from some of the more whole realities that are occurring right before our very eyes. Certainly the frogs being deformed as they are in such number is not some nasty miracle from God. Perhaps it is. Maybe it's just some miracle that we may not be able to find the answer to. Why children are suicidal? Do we need to run a study? We find out, oh, gee, so many children are wanting to commit suicide, and they are, and this is very serious, very sad. Do we need to run studies? Or do we need to not know that the lives that we are living are not giving the sustenance to the children? Do we need to not know ourselves and what we really need and what we really don't get and what we really don't give to our children? This is not to fault anybody, but obviously the things that make up in psychology has a long tradition, if you need it spelled out, of having shown from many decades prior what are the elements that go into bringing about somewhat of a more actualized and perfected, not perfected necessarily literally, but more pleasant, able to live kind of result for human beings. And we know what those factors are. We know what those factors are from having studied them in a more direct fashion in times past. And we know what people need to live. And yet we're off getting bits of information, ignoring and living in life circumstances that don't go to the core of how we're going to feel able to live, or better yet, want to live. Wanting to live, something up for grabs almost. Similarly, we cannot look at people as in situations of domestic violence and start to try to create patterns and then categorize people into what we think we know about occurrences of domestic violence and explain or think we're explaining or pigeonhole people on such bases. This is not a proper way to go about knowing things. Every situation is unique, and back to the phenomenology, certainly there are reasons, certainly there are causes, and there are generalizations, but don't get too specific in bringing those generalizations to a point on which you attach them. You must look at every circumstance and observe it and know it causally for what it is, uniquely for what it is, phenomenologically as it occurs, and listening to people and being more directly involved with people is how we get to know so very much. Thinking, using our thought processes without commercial purpose, without commercial design, without a reason to use them other than to be using them in and of themselves for the sake of it. And also when we do get together and talk, I already touched on this, let it not be just because of some problem. Let us not problemize everything we're addressing. If we go to talk to our children who are suicidal or who are living in such difficult circumstances, let us not decide to talk to them or sit down with them or send them to a counselor because we want to find out why it is they're suicidal. Let us talk to them directly for any particular reason. That's what's lacking. It doesn't always have to be a specific point of a problem that is the reason why we talk, the reason why we have shows, the reason why we have seminars, the reason why we get together or have meetings. I say, relax, flow, be real, be here now, be in life, live it, experience it. In a way, the way we proceed about our knowledges today, so to speak, or our informations, I should say, or our research studies, where everything is being researched, and yet who's carrying any kinds of whole knowledge with them in their own minds and hearts and souls? Or does it rest in computers somewhere, some kind of knowledge outside the human psyche? In a way, we are inanimating, deanimating, removing psyche from the equation. And remember, we talked about psyche the last time being the life force, the liveness, the soul, the spirit, the idea that you are breathing and alive. It's your guts, so to speak. It's your makeup as a human being. In a way, we are suffocating this. And we don't need to talk always about how many percents of people are categorized or rubricized or framed or formalized according to some specific study that doesn't necessarily get us to any closer connection between ourselves and life. The other thing is, I've mentioned him before, there is a musician or philosopher named George Clinton, who, when he was part of, I believe, Funkadelic, had an album called Devoid of Funk. And what he meant by that was that the get downness, the get with it and live it and sweat and feel and be a part of it and get loose and chill, so to speak, as people say today, and have a little liberty and not necessarily always have to be uptight, have to be technocratic, have to be bureaucratic, have to be void of humor. Of humor and looseness and laissez-faire and graciousness and pleasantry, but everything is tense. Everything is sterilized. He talked about devoid of funk, Cernot's devoid of funk. And also we have a kind of attitude that life is serious that goes along with this. Has to be, everything's very, very serious. An awful lot of this goes on in politics now. People take, oh, everything is very, very serious. We have to restrict, we have to curtail, we have to program, suppress, and so on, because everything is serious back to sort of our puritanical heritage, which brings its own kind of harshness into life. Which is not to say, none of this is to say to act with abandon or without scruples or immorally or frivolously or wantonly. Not at all. It's to say to become more relaxed and gracious and part of each other. Then we have the life is a drag. And we also have the life is absurd point of view. And we have no time for children. And we have problems like suicidality, aggression, and then we talk about running a study to figure out why. And maybe that is when life is absurd. One note, again, from music that I will refer to sort of sum up the commercialization of what all the pieces and bits of information are about and resulting in as they fill our environment, our mental and social environment. We can all recall the song, I Can't Get No Satisfaction, in which Mick Jagger says, a man comes on and tells me how white my shirts can be, and I can't be a man because I don't smoke the same cigarettes as he. I can't get no satisfaction. Kind of a stab at, I'm not really in life. I'm not really living it. I'm not being. This kind of stuff is inanity and does not fit the bill for what I or other human beings really need to live a rich and true life. I can remember, too, when Diane Keaton was in a movie, the name of which I can't recall, and got a baby by chance, an unlikely scenario, but it was there to prove the point, and she was of the corporate go-getter, move up the ladder kind of mentality at that time, and there was no place for a baby in her life. But anyway, as she did grow into loving this baby and dedicating her life to it, one of the things she did when she listened to the mothers in the neighborhood was take it to early developmental schools where you put cards in front of the child, for example, when they can't even speak yet, and you keep saying to them, this is President Kennedy, this is an orange, this is a camera, and so on, and forcing them, as so many people apparently do today. That's not what our children need, and that won't help against suicidality and aggression. In fact, it could possibly work against those things as it keeps them away from what they really need as children. Singing to children, telling them they're smart, worrying. I mean, we do have to support them and enrich them, but let us not put the cart before the horse of living, loving, flowing. Life is not something you assemble. You are assembled, and you have to make the most of it. In sum, regarding psychology, regarding underlying assumptions, I would say stay in the present to describe. We have to become explicit, meticulously, relatively unflawed, meaningful and disciplined describers of behaviors, livers, listeners, knowers. And instead of disciplining everything around us, including our children so much, we should discipline ourselves to be watching and loving and being in contact with and saying things that are not politically correct, but that are said because we maintain a discipline on ourselves to be better human beings. And we should, as for our own lives, as a book said by a philosopher, holy person, so to speak, I can't remember the name, a book called Be Here Now. Be in it. It's not the future. It's not the past. It's not the computer. Be here now. And it is passing through your hands like grains of sand. Be in it. Love it. Live it. Take down your guards. Take down your undisciplined kinds of ways of effortlessly feeling any way you want to. And perhaps we can get to some higher order consciousness. So now, because we are coming close to the end, I like to talk about psychology, and I have so much in store. Every time I start to go forward on it, things that I think about after I've had a session with you from the sides, other thoughts that sort of come in from the sides of things, from the history of things and from the surrounding atmosphere and philosophy of things come to my mind, and we slowly proceed getting more and more towards that goal of getting a grip on this area called psychology and philosophy to boot. But in addition to that, every time I try to make a move to deliver a show here on BNN TV of any sort, and I have had many kinds of shows, I'm always stalled by the inevitable environmental catastrophe, emergency, urgency, against which there are no other sciences, against which is so sad, so serious, so debilitating as to require complete and immediate attention. So to that end, I'm going to bring out to you something else that is happening in Indonesia besides the riots of late, which are happening around the time I am giving this talk. And these are the fires of the great rainforests of Indonesia, Borneo, Indonesia being a number of islands between Southeast Asia and Australia. And someone writes, I'm living on the island of Borneo, which is reputed to be the third largest on Earth. For well over 2 months now, an eerie and poisonous pall of gloom has canopied the tropical skies of Southeast Asia as environmental vandalism on a massive scale is being perpetrated in Indonesia. The super-rich timber barons are burning down the rainforest to replace it with the monoculture of palm oil trees. And palm oil, you will see in some products we use here, especially soaps, but also potato chips may sometimes have it, and so on. Schools have been told to close. Huge inconvenience is caused to travelers, and people have been advised to stay indoors. Recently, visibility was down to 1 meter in Kuching, Sarawak. The Indonesian government selfishly ignored the seriousness of the situation until the wind changed direction temporarily and blew the noxious fumes back towards them. The situation is now out of control as the coal seams near the surface are burning as well. So far, 1,970,000 acres have been wiped out. The unprecedented dry spell is expected to last for at least another 3 months due to the El Nino influence. The Indonesian authority originally blamed the native Sweden farmers of Kalimantan, but this was a cover-up for the licensed logging and plantation companies who deliberately set these fires every year. Despite the pious platitudes being mouthed, it's extremely unlikely that these legalized vandals will be brought to book. The dream dies hard, says another newspaper. The forests which once humbled humankind are now broken and burning, and as the world awakens to an ecological disaster in Southeast Asia, the naivete of those who trusted the permanence of nature and the conceit and greed of those who challenged it is being laid bare. The early explorers of Borneo found a tropical canopy so dense that from a distance the tops of trees looked like smooth fields of grass. It was said an orangutan could travel from the south to the north of the vast island without descending from the treetops. So moist was the forest, soaking up the rains, which fell 4 days out of five on average, that it lay like a moist band around the equator. These were cool, clean lungs of Asia. Now Asia's lungs, laid open by decades of rampant logging, are ablaze, and tens of millions of people are choking in vast clouds of smog. And now it is not just the great trees which are burning. The land itself is on fire. Tens of thousands of hectares of rainforest peat, the most important natural element in fighting greenhouse carbon gases, has been ignited and are facing permanent destruction. These are coming from articles in the Sydney Morning Herald, in the letter to the editor from a resident of Brunei, to the Irish Times. This is what's going on in Indonesia. These were happening in late 97. I believe those fires continue to burn. Very difficult to work in the forest now. This continual smoke inhalation makes walking very tiring. Also, primates and other animals are now very clearly being affected. Siamang and Onko, which are agile gibbons, have virtually ceased long calls. Hornbills also uncharacteristically silent, judging by the scrape marks and calls heard over the past 10 days. The smoke is also causing stress and tension among tigers. Is this situation making news in America? Writes a biologist working in Sumatra. More than 100 orangutans been abused or killed by the locals when they flee the forest. And palm oil and paper are the products coming out of these places, and the reason they are being torched to be used for palm and paper plantations. Sadly, the forests of Amazonia are also burning, and the African forests are being rapidly destroyed, and we in the United States have one-third less trees than we had in the past, leaving the future bleak for forest peoples and animals. We are in total emergency. There is nothing other than environment when it comes to life. And finally, I'd like to also always end with an animal story, of which there are so many that continue to go on right around us. A person who's trying to speak for the apes that are held in research centers around the United States, including one right here in Southborough, Massachusetts, is traveling around with a stuffed toy army of apes, and he makes a protest, a vigil, outside these facilities with his so-called ape army. And when he went to one facility in California, they would not let him sit during the times that the employees would be coming out of the building, which is the point of what he's doing. So he was arrested. His bail was set as $3,000. He was strip searched, placed in a hole reserved for prisoners who misbehave for 4 days, not allowed to bathe, given no toilet paper, no mirror, no pillow. The light in his cell shone 24 hours a day. He accepted all this, saying, "More than anything else, my stay in solitary confinement reinforced what I knew only intellectually about the conditions and plight of the primate prisoners held by our government. Most monkeys and apes are exponentially more sociable than humans. Thousands of them are held in isolation. The anguish I felt from only 4 days of such treatment pales to insignificance compared with a lifetime of loneliness. Throughout the NIH system, monkeys are beating their heads against the walls of their cells, chewing holes in their arms, or huddling in helpless desperation." He awaits trial for his so-called crimes, and his motto is, "Stand up, sit down, and speak up." Now, we don't want to always just be problem-focused either, but do not these things impinge upon our life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, and our desire to move into the future with optimism. I want to point out to you also that I have a book called The Psychology of Human Life, which is a collection of essays. Thank you very much for tuning in. We will continue to be giving you more shows. So keep watching and call if you have any questions or comments. Thank you.